Can anyone see that? Think about the steel that's in blue, right? You got the head above the aluminum plate. And then you have the vertical piece, the rod attached to the head. So think about the head and the actual rod. Is there any shearing action taking place? Can anything separate? When you apply this force, the rod can actually shear off the head. Okay, so that's where the other constraint of 180 megapascal comes into play. And that is the hardest part of this problem, being able to see that. Okay, so I'm going to address, and we'll just do this one, it's not that hard. So here's my first constraint. Again, remember I said to you, you're going to have to address individual constraints, right? And again, if we're applying this force P here, and we're looking for the value of P because that's not given. Now for the steel, what were the diameter? Diameter is 12. And then the thickness is 10. So I'm going to start with my formula for the shear stress. We're given our allowable or the design constraint of shear stress, which is the maximum of 180. So that is given to us. We can certainly determine the shearing plane, the area. We have that. The only thing we do not have is the force P that will cause the shearing action to take place, right? Again, in this case, our ultimate shear strength is 180 because it's our maximum is set at 180. So rewriting this formula, we're solving for the force P. We have the shear stress times the area. Let me write that here so I have more space. Our shear stress given is 180 megapascal. And how do we determine the area? Again, remember I used my paper hole puncher, right? After the punching process was completed, what do we get? We got a disc of paper, right? So if shearing were to occur in this case, can you guys visualize the removed portion of this steel rod? It will be a disc, right? With a diameter of 12 millimeters. And what's removed is the portion of the head with the thickness of 10 millimeters. So again, we use the circumference of the circle and the thickness, in this case, of the steel. Megapascal is Newton millimeter square, pi. Our diameter in this case is 12 millimeters and the thickness is 10 millimeters. Millimeter squares are canceled out. Again, I would encourage you guys to carry out your dimensional analysis first. And then the P value that I get that will push the limit up to 180 megapascal of the shear stress, the P has to be 67,858.4013 newtons. Now, is this our final answer for this question? Absolutely not. Okay. This just happens to be one of the p-values. Okay. So I will come back to this. We're not done. Then I will continue to constraint number two. And that is for the aluminum, right? The maximum value is set to 70 megapascal. So this constraint is referring to if we were to apply the force P, what value of P would cause shearing action to take place in through the aluminum plate? So the entire head of the steel rod has to be punched through the aluminum plate. So this is similar to our punching process example. This is my aluminum plate. So as the force P is applied, the entire head would shear through the aluminum plate. Okay, once separated. And what would this thickness be? This is the separated aluminum.
Eight millimeters.
Very good. What about the diameter?
Forty millimeters.
Very good, because it's of the head. Let me squeeze that in here. 40 millimeters. Very good. So let me start once again with my formula. My allowable shear stress, 70 megapascal, is given. I can certainly figure out the area. And then P is the missing piece. So P is equal to shear stress times the area. All right, diameter is 40. And the thickness is 8.
Wouldn't the disc be hollow, though, since there's a space in between?
We would consider that to be, because this is being separated through, okay? So you're looking at, I know what you're trying to say, but this is the shearing plane, right? Okay. I think what you're getting confused with the normal stress right here, the area, right, Ty? Very good question. No, that's not a donut. That looks like a donut. Okay, so this P we get is 70,371.6754 newtons. Okay, so because we got two design constraints, I have two values of P that will push the limit to 70 megapascal and one for 180 megapascal, right? But the question is asking for the largest load P that can be applied, satisfying both of these limits. So of course you cannot apply both forces of 70,000 newtons and what was the other one? 68,000 newtons. You can't apply both, right? So that means you have to decide of the two values of P, which one do you apply to this assembly so that you are working well within the shear stress limits?
The larger one?
If I apply the larger P, what would happen to my 180 megapascal? Now, sometimes it's harder for you guys to see because we're at the beginning of our class. So if you don't quite know which one to apply, what should you do? How can you do this without kind of deciding on an answer? Is there another way to actually show which one would work better? You can work it out mathematically, right? Plug it back into each formula, okay? And you will see that one of the shear stresses will be violated, will exceed the limit. So in this case, it's gotta be the smaller size, 67,900 newtons, or if you convert this, either answer would be fine. Either 67,900 newtons or 67.9 kilonewtons. I think this was the hardest one of the three I think I assigned for this week. Okay, so take a look at this one. It is similar to your punching process, but it was taking one more step farther than that. So I see Jason is here, who else? Okay. So we're still missing Bobby and Eileen. I have not heard anything from them. I hope they're okay. Jonathan, do you know if Eileen is okay? I don't know if you talked. I think you talked to her, right, Jonathan? Maybe, maybe not.
The rod and the head, then the shear between them wouldn't matter, right?
It would still matter. That would be a punching process. So imagine if you were to take that force pit, take it to the top of the punching rod, the steel rod, using its line of action of the force, it would still become the punching process problem.
I meant like on the top of the head that's connected to the rod.
If you were to move the force P?
Yeah. It would still do the same thing, but then...
Yeah.
But then you wouldn't risk the separation between the rod and the head, right?
Oh, no, that's why it's a different one. That was our class problem. This is why this is similar to it, but not exactly the same. This is why it's taking one step further.
Got it.
Yes.
Jonathan has a good point. He said, should we round down instead of up because of the capacity?
Who's saying this? Oh, is it Jonathan or so on something like this? And instead of round up. In this case, I think the difference from 67,858 to 67,900 is so negligible. I wouldn't think that would be make any significant difference, honestly. Okay. Because again, when we round up or round down using the significant figures, that is well within our margin of error. So it should be fine. Okay, very good. Any other questions? Okay, then let me switch over to our notes. Okay, so here is your third and final type of stress in chapter one. Now for homework three, I'm just going to warn you a little bit here because I am assigning homework three for this week. There are some problems that are going to be very difficult or complex problems. And the ones that I would like for you guys to pay attention to, especially 1.24, I would give 3 stars because it is an excellent problem. It's what I consider to be a summary integrated problem for the entire chapter one. 1.23, I will put just one star because that will help you with 1.24. Now, when you look at 1.24 homework problem, you'll be a little scared at first. But maybe being scared is okay, just a little bit, because it will keep you alert. This 1.24, again, I call this a summary problem because it will address all three different types of stresses from chapter one. Normal stress, shear stress, and finally our bearing stress, sigma sub B. This is the one that we're going to be covering today. So once we're done with this class today, you should be able to try the first four homework problems. The last three are related to, I believe, the oblique plane. So if you don't get to 1.29, 32, and 33, I'm okay with that, but you should at least get started with 19, 20, 23, and 24. Okay, most definitely, I would like to go over 1.24 with you guys in class, and that's going to take a very long time for us to discuss because there's a lot going on in problem 1.24. Why am I keep talking about 1.24? Because if I were to give you a test problem, this is something that you guys can expect because it's entire chapter one pretty much. Okay, it's an excellent problem. So we will come back to that eventually, but let's get started with our notes for today on bearing stress. Again, I've mentioned this to you before. I don't know why they're using the same Greek letter for the bearing stress, but that's what they do, so we'll just go along with that. So bearing stress is a compressive stress exerted on an external surface of a body. So what does that mean? I usually refer to as this as a contact pressure. So it is it's a type of compressive stress, okay? Now pay attention to anything that says in red or in note. For flat surfaces in contact, the bearing area is the area in which the forces transfer from one member to another. Now, if you don't understand what this means yet, this is just my side note to try to explain it to you. If you don't quite get it, that's okay. But just like the first two stresses, the formula looks the same, right? It's P over A. That's all we've had so far. It's the area. And this is where you have to understand this part. Area in which the force is transferred from one member to another. Now, when it comes to bearing stress, there's the contact pressure, such as one area on top of another, or there's a bearing stress in connections. For the bearing stress in connections, I am going to have you guys read it from the textbook. I'm going to cover the basic bearing stress, but I'm going to have you guys be responsible for looking at the application of the bearing stress in your book for the connections. Why? Because I would like to discuss that as part of your 1.24 homework problem. So you're getting a small reading assignment from me. Now, the bearing stress itself in concept is not very difficult. It's whatever the area the two objects come in contact with. Okay, it's as simple as that. So let me show you an example here. And I will go back to that problem statement. By the way, you guys do not have to necessarily write down the problem statement because I post these notes before class at 9 o'clock. Everything is usually available by 9 o'clock. So you guys can just refer to it. Okay, so we have two bodies here. One is the concrete footing and one is the timber post. So we're going to apply a compressive force of 22,000 pounds on the top of the post. Again, it looks like a single point of contact, but it really isn't, right? Again, we're taking the resultant force of the applied force into a single point of contact. So when I say the transfer of force from one area to another, so can you guys visualize a contact area between the timber post and the concrete footing? Right? I'm sure you guys can. If I were to it's not that pretty, but that's the contact area, right? You guys can visualize that, right? Right at the bottom of the timber post and the top of the footing, that is our contact area. So this 22,000 pounds of force, even though it's being applied to the post. When the post is being supported by another body, in this case, a concrete footing, we're going to transfer that load from the timber post onto the concrete footing. Then what happens to that load? Because the concrete footing isn't coming in contact with the soil underneath it. Where does that 22,000 pounds of force go? It is transferred from the post to the footing to
the ground.
Sure, the ground, the soil, right? Okay, very good. So depending on the area of the contact surface, the stress induced will vary, okay? So let's take a look at this problem here. Let me go back to the problem statement. The problem statement is very lengthy, but the work itself isn't very hard. This is a straightforward use of the bearing stress formula. So you have a timber column, which is subjected to a compressive load of 22,000 pounds. The column is supported by a 2-foot square concrete footing that is in turn supported by the soil. So in part A, compute the bearing stress on the contact surface between the column and the footing. And in part B, compute the bearing stress at the base of the footing. Now we're going to neglect the weight of the footing and the column. But if we had to consider the weight, would that make any more difficult? You just add one more force to it, right? Or the combined forces, that's it. Okay, but that's not the purpose of this. So let's go ahead and do this together. So in part A, we're looking at the post and the footing. I'm going to start with my formula for the bearing stress. The load applied to the timber column is 22,000 pounds. And the area. So I want you guys to take a look at this picture here and the contact area between the post and the footing. And can you guys help me to identify the dimensions that will give me the area of this contact surface?
Is it just 5.5 inches times 5.5 inches?
Very good. So it's 5.5 inches times 5.5 inches. I guess I should use the word column. Oh, I should just give you the answer. I guess 727.2727. So we get pound divided by inch square. We're using three significant figures. We get 727 psi. This is the bearing stress. Remember in the red little notation that I had before, the load is being transferred from the timber column to the concrete footing. So this problem is more of a civil engineering problem. Not necessarily mechanical, but civil. The ones in connections is what I consider to be more mechanical. So remember I said the load is being transferred from one body to another, right? So the load of 22,000 pounds applied to the timber post is being transferred from the timber post or column to the concrete footing. Now in part B, we're going to take that and then redistribute it to the soil underneath the concrete footing. So before we calculate the stress, the bearing stress between the footing and the soil, do you think the bearing stress should go up or go down in part B?
It should go down if we're distributing the stress evenly along the footing, which was going to be my question. If the post is in the center of the footing, doesn't most of the stress go underneath the post and not?
Well, it just depends on whether it's in the middle or not. It depends on the contact surface area. Okay, so very good. Okay, so let's start with our formula once again. Now, later on, sigma sub B will be used to represent another different type of stress. But by the time we get to that chapter, you will forget about this bearing stress. So I'm not to worry about it. But if you do remember sigma sub B, it's going to be used for another stress, bending stress in the future. Again, I don't know why they use the same letter, but that's what they do. Okay, so can someone help me to identify the dimensions for the area in this case between the footing and the soil?
It's 24 inches by 24 inches.
Okay, because you got 24 inches from 2 feet, right?
Yep. Yeah.
But I'm going to write it as 2 feet because I want to take this opportunity to carry out conversion with you. Okay, so let me make it a little, actually, let me do it here. Because this is a topic that I covered in your intro to engineering as well, because it's a common mistake. So I think that was Khaled who converted our 2 feet to 24 inches, right? So what's the conversion factor here? It's 1 foot equivalent to 12 inches, right? But we got to do this twice. So typically students put the square here, but very often they forget to square 12. So it might be better if you guys consider doing the squares individually. That way you don't forget to square the actual numerical value and not just the unit itself, because that's a very, very common mistake. And the answer we get is, what is it, 38.1944 pound inch square, or sigma sub B is equal to 38.2 PSI. Now, it is okay to not convert from feet to inches, especially in civil engineering, because they do use the pound per foot square. That's another unit that they use. But the reason why I wanted you guys to convert from feet to inches is so that we can compare the part A and part B answers. So the bearing stress in part B between the footing and the soil is smaller because of the area is much larger, right? Okay, now that wasn't so hard, was it? Now, so we'll just increase the level of complexity, and the homework problem 1.24 will be the ultimate. So let's continue here. I think I got plenty of blank spaces. Okay, so I'm going to increase the level just a little bit here. So let me show you the picture first. So this is a type of connection. And again, we have wooden piece, and then through it is a connection. But underneath the head of the bolt, we have a steel plate. And the diameter of the bolt is 25 millimeters, and we're going to apply a tensile force and pull on it. So let's see what the question is asking for. So a 25 millimeter diameter bolt extends vertically through a timber beam as shown. The maximum tensile stress developed in the bolt is 83 megapascal. So it says the maximum tensile stress that develops in the bolt is 83 megapascal. So even though it's the writing is not exactly like the, you know, the maximum stress is limited to. So it's a little bit of different language here, but it means the same thing. This is our limit. Determine the minimum required diameter for a circular steel plate that is to be placed under the head of the bolt. The bearing stress on the timber is not to exceed 3.4 megapascal. So we are comfortable with the normal stress, whether it's a compressive stress or a tensile stress. We know this one. We know how to deal with this. We're looking for the diameter, but we cannot exceed the bearing stress between the head of the bolt and the timber of 3.4 megapascal. So it seems like we got two constraints here, right? So what else is missing? What is missing here besides the diameter?
The load.
The load, very, was it Ryan? Very good. The load P is not given to us. Very good. So how do we get to P? Or can we solve D first and then get to P? What do you think?
We could sub in the max values for the stress and then use that to find P? Or do we have enough to find the area?
Very good, Ryan. So Ryan is saying that use the stress to solve for P. I think that's what I heard from you, right? So it's going to be a two-step process. Remember here in the problem statement, the maximum tensile stress developing in the bolt is 83 megapascal, right? So the question here is, what is causing the 83 megapascal? What load P is causing this to be induced? So from this statement, we're going to find P and then apply that to our bearing stress. Okay, very good. Let me get to... So it's saying that the induced stress find the value of P that is responsible for inducing the tensile stress of 83 megapascal. This is our normal tensile stress. We're looking for force P. Rewrite this. And what is the formula for our area in this problem, in this case, for the tensile stress? So going back to the picture here, we're going to take the cross section right here in the bolt, right? And when we do, what is the shape of the cross-sectioning plane?
Is it hollow?
It's not hollow in this case. It's going to be solid, but it will be a solid circular, right? Okay. Jaehyun, I think you're referring to the other piece that we're going to be eventually looking for.
Yes, I think I was thinking of, yeah, the steel plate.
Yeah, exactly. Very good. So this one is going to be solid. So we're going to use pi d square. Again, let me write that formula here for you. for the area. And the diameter was 25 millimeter. Oh, there's a message. Oh, 25 mil. Okay, good. I just saw your message, Jonathan. Okay, millimeter squares are canceled out. So our P responsible for 83 megapascal works out to 40,742.52 newtons. So that's the amount of load that is responsible for inducing 83 megapascal of the tensile stress. Now we're going to take this load, it's got to be the same P, right? Then we're going to apply this to the bearing stress. We're looking for the required diameter. So we're looking for the part of the area. Bearing stress, we're given that 3.4. And the load, we just found it in step one. This is supposed to be step two. Rewriting this
formula. We not need to know the size of the bolt head. The size of the bolt head.
Yes. Oh, hold on, Jason. Hold on. Okay. I'll get there. Okay. So let me just rewrite this formula. So we got A equal to the load that we found in part A divided by the bearing stress allowed. Now for this area A, let's go back to the picture. Let's go back up to the picture right here. Now we're looking for the required diameter of the steel plate. So looking at this picture, does it answer your question right now, Jason?
I don't believe so. The top-down view shows, I'm guessing that's the bolt and not through the steel plate and not the head resting on top of
it. Okay. Okay. We're looking at the minuscule differences here. Okay. Very good. So first of all, here's our steel plate, which is circular, right? So from the top view, we have this. This is a top view. And we're looking at the bearing stress between the steel plate. Let me use a different color. And the wood. So here is our plane for the contact surface area, right? Okay. And through which we have the 25 millimeter bolt. So inside the circular plate is actually the diameter of the bolt, not the head. Do you see it, Jason?
Does that help? Yes, okay. that helps.
Okay, very good. So if I were to remove this portion right here in orange, this is what it looks like on the right-hand side. I don't want to mess up my pretty picture here, but okay. So maybe I will shade this. So the shaded orange here is the contact surface area between the steel plate and the wooden piece. Okay, very good. Let me go back down. I gotta scroll down again. Where is it? Oh, right here. Okay, so having said that, what should be our area formula for the contact surface?
Disc.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
A disc.
Okay, for the circular disc, right? So what is that formula? What formula should we use?
Pi P.
Okay, it's for the hollow, right? I think that's what you... Okay, so I'll put it down for you. So I got the outside diameter square minus the inside diameter square divided by 4. and I'm solving for the outside diameter because the inside diameter is determined by the diameter of the bolt. Now, I know some of you guys didn't quite use the same notations on your last quiz, but for the outside, it's conventional to use D sub O for the outside or the outer diameter, and then D sub I for the inner diameter. That's pretty conventional in engineering, D sub O and D sub I. Okay, our load that we found in step one. Let me copy this down, 5297. And then our bearing stress limitation is 3.4 megapascal, but I'm just gonna convert it here to Newton divided by millimeter square. Let me just save some space here. Plus 25 square millimeter square. My newtons cancels out. And my outside diameter five to four. And our required diameter for the circular plate works out to 126.0 millimeters. Now, formulas like this will show up all throughout the semester. So just be careful with your math, algebra. How are you guys doing with these two steps? Not bad, right? Now again, this is just a warm-up for your 1.24 homework problem. And for that, I'm asking you guys to look at the bearing stress. Oh, sorry, in case you guys are not done. The bearing stress in connections. Okay, we're still not. Okay. Let's see. Do we have Bobby? Oh, Jonathan, you got two screens up. Okay, I see. Okay, I thought Bobby has shown up. Okay, very good. Okay, I think you guys are done, all staring at me, so I'm gonna scroll down. Okay, so this is the part that I want you guys to read as part of your homework, section 1.2C. And I'm actually giving you the area formula that you need to use, but I want you guys to read about this more in connections. And in this type of connection problems, we're going to use the area formula that is different from what we were using before in our class examples. And A is going to be determined by diameter times the thickness. I want you guys to read this before you approach homework problem 1.24. And we'll talk about it in class. Okay, so the final topic of chapter one, a stress on an oblique plane under axial loading, but it really should be stresses. And we're going to be looking at, once again, the normal and the shear stress. They're not going away. These two are not going away. So let me show you what it looks like here. And we're going to be taking notes. I got notes prepared because remember I said we're going to derive these formulas together, right? I'm not going to just throw the formulas at you. I want to make sure you guys understand this. So when it's time for you guys to compare these formulas to the Mohr circle technique, you guys will know where these came from. So let me start with this example, this illustration. This is not very different from where we started, right? We have let's assume a prismatic bar, and I have a tensile force being applied to it. But what if, and I don't want you guys to draw this, what if instead of passing a cutting plane straight across like this, okay? What if I pass a cutting plane at an angle? And that's what makes this problem a little difficult. Now, important to note here, when you do this, we're going to draw, and I want you guys to pay attention to this one, because if you don't quite get this language down, it may become difficult for you to understand. So I have an oblique plane here, and I'm going to draw a line perpendicular to this oblique plane. Line normal to or perpendicular to the oblique plane. Notice that I have included angle theta. Theta is an angle measured from the longitudinal axis of the member to the brand new normal line to the oblique plane. So theta is an angle measured between the line normal to the oblique plane and the longitudinal axis of the member. And that angle is important. Now, if this angle is not given, if this is not given, then you should find it before you apply these formulas. So we're defining this angle theta here. So let's go a little deeper into this problem. I'm going to come back to this. And you guys, I think I gave you this slide. And if you did not print out your slides, you may want to draw this because we're going to draw all over this. So I took half where the oblique plane was passed, right? So similar to, you know, if we were to pass a cutting plane, you isolate one of the two sections of the cutting plane. That's exactly what we're doing here. And again, I have transferred over to this picture the line that is normal to our oblique plane with the angle theta. And of course, P prime is representing the internal resisting force. Now we're going to go back to our statics. With respect to this oblique plane, the force P, whether it is a P prime or P, because they're essentially the same, right? P prime is the same as your P. It doesn't matter which one you look at. But on this oblique plane, we're going to take our original force, either P or P prime. And because our plane is now at an angle, it's an inclined force with respect to that oblique plane. So if you have an inclined force, what do we do in your statics?
We want to break it into its X and Y components.
Excellent. That's what we're going to do. So I'm going to take my P right here, my P prime, and I'm going to resolve this into components. So this oblique plane essentially is becoming my X, and this new line normal to the oblique plane is my Y. So I'm going to call this, just like in your statics, my P sub Y and P sub X. Now, do I have to call it P prime X and P prime Y? No, because P prime is the same as P. It doesn't really matter, right? Are you guys still with me on this? Okay, now think about the types of stresses that each component force is responsible for. P sub Y is perpendicular to the plane. If it's perpendicular, what type of stress is induced as a result of that?
Normal.
Normal, very good. Okay. What about P sub X? That is parallel to the plane. What stress is induced as a result of parallel forces?
Shearing.
Very good. Very good. Okay. So you have try to make them all the same, but I can't. So you have the normal stresses. Sigma. And then let me just use a different color here for the shear stress. Okay, tau. I'm just going to go back to the slide before this and I will come back to it. Just hold on. So let me just summarize what we said here. Components parallel to the oblique plane, P sub x, induces the shearing stress. Component that is perpendicular or normal to the oblique plane produces the normal stress. And that's what we're trying to illustrate in these pictures. Now let's go down to the next slide and fill in some information, because we're going to derive formulas for the shear stress and the normal stress for the oblique plane. Now I got some blank spaces here because we're going to fill this in together. So P sub X, which is the shear stress. Now looking at the components here, this is just a statics question. Using P sub X, I want to rewrite P sub X in terms of the original force P and the angle theta. So my P sub X, which is right here, directly opposite to the angle theta, and therefore it is P times sine of theta. And P sub X is responsible for producing the shear stress. By formula, it says shear stress is equal to P over A. But specifically, P is what we're calling P sub X. And let me talk about the area here. I'm gonna come back to this, but can we take a look at this together here? Now, even though I just drew this in 2D, but in 3D, you have, I'm gonna make this messy, so bear with me, right? The top of this. We're gonna call this area A sub theta. Okay. So my shear stress is equal to P sub X, it's the X component of the force on this oblique plane, and our new area, our cutting plane or the cross-sectioning plane on which the shear stress will be developing is called A sub theta. A sub theta is not the same as our original area. Okay, because of the angle theta. So again, coming back down here, my shear stress is equal to P sub X divided by the new area, which is A sub theta. Similarly, we can do the same thing for our P sub Y that is adjacent to the angle theta. So it's P times cosine of theta. And we're going to indicate that this force is responsible for producing the normal stress. Again, the formula for the normal stress is straightforward, P over A, and we're going to apply our P sub Y divided by our A sub theta. Now we got these two new formulas after resolving the original force into X and Y components and identifying the new area over which the stresses should be developing. We have to take these a step further. The next question is this. How do we find these A sub theta? Okay, and this is where, and we're not done with this slide, we're gonna come back to it eventually. But the question is, how do we determine that A sub theta? A sub zero, the original area is quite straightforward. Most likely it will be given to us, but how do we determine A sub theta? So let's take a look at the 3D version of the same picture. And this is what I was trying to show you before. So if you guys don't have this printout, you may want to sketch this because we're going to write all over it. Let me use a different color. Okay. So looking at this picture, I want to start with the original area, A sub zero, my original area. Assuming that we're given the dimensions of the length L and the width W, how can I determine the original area? Well, it's simple, right? It's L times W. We all can see that, right? Okay. But this time, I want to be looking at A sub theta. Now, I try to create most of the information on this slide so that you guys don't have to do it yourselves, but I'm going to focus on this triangle in the front of this member. Oh, maybe I should use a different color. What would stand out better? Maybe green. It's a right triangle. Just looking at that triangle, what other dimensions do we know about this one? What else do we know about this right triangle?
We know its length.
Very good. It's the same as the original length, right? Very good. Okay. And I also should know that angle theta is right here. Now, where am I going with this? This green right triangle is relevant to our area A sub theta because I want to know, let me take this out. This is my A sub theta. And here's my green triangle. Okay. Now to find A sub theta, I need to know the hypotenuse of this triangle. And for A sub theta, do we know its width?
Yes.
Yes, it's exactly the same width. Here's my W, right? And this is what I'm calling, I don't want to make too much mess here, but that's the hypotenuse. So for the A sub theta, if I know the hypotenuse of that right triangle times the original width, I should be able to find it. This is where that green right triangle comes in. I need to get that hypotenuse. So if I do cosine of theta is equal to L, the length, divided by the hypotenuse of the right triangle, my hypotenuse then will be L divided by cosine of theta. I'm going to take this, take it up. And make substitution. Then times the width. So I get L times the width divided by cosine of theta. But what is L times W?
A sub zero.
Very good. That is our original area that's given, divided by cosine of theta. Remember I said to you, you should have your theta. If not given, you have to determine what that theta is, right? So our new area of the cutting plane is equal to the original area divided by cosine of theta. Okay, now let's take our new area formula back to our formulas, which is basically below here. Okay, so from the previous slide, we were up to here. And I said we will come back to it, right? So let's go ahead and make substitutions. Our P sub x is equal to P times sine of theta. And our a sub theta now is equal to the original area divided by cosine of theta. Rewriting this, we can find the shear stress on any oblique plane by this formula. I got original force P times sine of theta times cosine of theta divided by the original area. Now this formula, we can put a box around. Let's continue down to our normal stress. Our P sub Y is P times cosine theta divided by A sub zero times cosine theta. So our normal stress on any oblique plane or any angle theta for that matter is equal to P times cosine theta square divided by the original area. Now you guys can take these two formulas with you after TNCC when you guys transfer over to a four-year school, right? When you guys further analyze for the solid mechanics, you guys can easily use these two formulas because we have them now fully derived. These can be used in conjunction or in place of the Mohr circle, which make I think they're much easier to use. But do we have any questions about how these formulas or the picture? Any questions on these? Okay, now that the hard work is done, the next part is going to be very straightforward and very easy because all we gotta do is go back to these two formulas and make substitutions for any angle theta. You can use it for angle theta of 0, 90, 180, 275. If you want any theta, for any theta, this will work. But of course, it will be limited to 0 and 90 though. Okay. So let's take a look at an easy example problem here. A square steel bar, 1 inch by 1 inch in cross section, is subject to a tensile load of 20,000 pounds. So here's the picture, okay? But we're going to vary the angles. Compute the tensile and the shear stresses on inclined planes where the normal lines are making angles of 30, 45, and 60 with a longitudinal axis of the member. Compute the maximum tensile stress and indicate on which plane this would be developed. Part B, to me, is more interesting. We're looking for the maximum stress, and then on which plane, meaning what angle theta. Okay, now I know we're almost out of time, but you guys can do this very easily. Just go back to the tensile and the shear stress if you want, or we can come back on Wednesday and I can do these very quickly for you. We're just gonna make two columns of work, one for the tensile, one for the shear stress, and we're just gonna fill it in for three different angles, so 30, 45, and 60. And my, I guess what I'm more interested in is really the part B discussion. That's what I want to really talk about. Okay, I got only 1 minute left, so I'll just stop here. I have to remind you guys that tomorrow the office hour will be canceled. I will not be available for office hour tomorrow because I have things to take care of in the morning related to my family, so I won't be available tomorrow. But if you guys have any questions, you guys can always email me, or if you need to meet with me, then request for an appointment and we'll set something up. Okay.